Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Behind the Bear's Ears, Exploring the Cultural and Natural Histories of a Sacred Landscape by R. E. Burrillo, narrated by Charles Constant. Foreword, a healing movement. Sing your song, write your stories, and paint your pictures of this place we know as home, Bear's Ears. Home to the ancestors, plants, animals, elements, and newcomers. As a young girl, I would travel with my family to the small community of White Mesa for community gatherings. White Mesa, Utah, is a part of the Ute Mountain Ute Tribal Reservation. I greet the elders as my grandparents. Our Mother Earth and Father, the Creator, we acknowledge their presences with gratitude. In 2015, the southeastern region in Utah grabbed the world's attention and united the native people who live in and historically occupied the area. Voices from the past speak to each of us with urgency. The flowers, sage, and great cedar trees move in a way that reminds us of our ancestors and their movement. How do we know they were here and alive? The ancient Pueblo structures and canyon walls tell the stories of days gone by. To protect this shared home, a group of indigenous people came together to be the voice of the land, elements, animals, ancient structures, and cultural ways of life. Five native nations, Navajo, Ute Mountain Ute, Hopi, Pueblo of Zuni, and Ute Indian Tribe of Utah, became the Bear's Ears Intertribal Coalition. My grandparents told me we get nowhere in life alone. Healing became the vehicle to travel the path toward permanent protection and access to the land. Healing relationships between the tribes led to the realization that allies would be necessary. Archaeologists, conservation leaders, and recreation visitors who come to love this place too. As we learned from one another, we also understood it didn't matter how and when you and your family arrived. We need each other. Healing relationships from a personal place allowed for the healing to radiate outward, drawing strength, clarity, and understanding from within the circle of life. We all breathe the same air and share space. It is time to inspire each to share their truth. With courage, we ride the lightning bolt to deliver the message. We are standing together. Together, beyond tribal differences, contemporary or historical, ethnicity and religion, we will stand together. As unique as each indigenous group in this world, our stories weave the beautiful diversity of our space, our region, our Bear's Ears. I became a voice on behalf of my Ute Mountain Ute people, not realizing I would become a leader for the greater campaign for Bear's Ears National Monument. Serving as the only woman in the coalition, my role was an integral piece of the entire movement. My heart shined through as a daughter, mother, and grandmother, as my mother and grandmothers prepared me. With the grace of respect, words, and actions, we showed the world that an exchange of negativity was not the solution. Peaceful actions proved to be the strength of the core healing spirit of the movement. As citizens of our tribes, counties, states, and nations, we are the public. All our voices are necessary in the process of decision-making. Together we shall sing our songs, paint our pictures, and share our truths. Together we stand with Bear's Ears. We stand in sacred places where our grandparents and ancestors once stood, inviting allies to protect and love this beauty too. The wind blows through the trees, singing of the generations of yesterday. The sun warms Mother Earth today. Braiding the knowledge of our ancestors, scientific data, and the process of democracy inspires our continued efforts to protect sacred open spaces that we share. Our Mother Earth is me, as I am her. Regina Lopez Whiteskunk. Introduction. In January of 2017, just days after Bear's Ears National Monument was proclaimed in southeast Utah, I had the immense privilege of being invited to an event celebrating its establishment at Monument Valley in the Navajo Nation. I was living in Cortez, Colorado at the time, just about halfway between my two on-again, off-again homes of Flagstaff, Arizona and Salt Lake City, Utah, and had to make the long, cold drive by myself. My route took me around Canyons of the Ancients National Monument, a Bill Clinton creation from 2000 that was proclaimed in order to protect 175,100 acres of the San Juan region, the vast drainage basin of the San Juan River, centered on the Four Corners, of which Bears Ears is the westernmost natural and cultural province. It had snowed recently. The final stretch through the northernmost portion of the Navajo Nation was thickly blanketed in white, and my vehicle pirouetted less than gracefully during the dozen or so times that I lost control of it. I wondered how many people were willing to make this perilous journey just to celebrate the recent proclamation of a national monument, when they could easily wait until the snow melted and go to see the place itself. The answer, when I finally arrived, turned out to be hundreds. I carried a notebook with me. I often do. The notes I took at the celebration were added to an assemblage of scribblings comprising about 13 years of thoughts, observations, experiences, and archaeological research focused on southeast Utah. My first encounter with what would become Bears Ears National Monument was in 2006. I was not yet an archaeologist, merely an aficionado of the old and interesting. I spent a week in November backpacking through the upper third of Grand Gulch, the great defile that cuts through the impressive landmass of Cedar Mesa, beneath the gaze of the Bears Ears formations. Much of my time was spent marveling over how scarcely visited such a wondrous and heavenly place could be. In the 4 days I spent down in the gulch and 3 additional days spent atop Cedar Mesa, I saw exactly 3 other people, including a fellow backpacker to whom I gave a ride between trailheads so he could complete a loop. We hardly said a word to each other. That was then. Things have changed quite a bit. By the time I got involved in research and conservation efforts in the Bears Ears area, I was paying off a rather sizable karmic debt that I felt I owed the place, and it isn't scarcely visited anymore. Early archaeologists like Alfred A.V. Kidder, that tendency of going by the first 2 initials in publication is a venerated one among archaeologists, regarded the entire San Juan region as a single cultural area. The archaeologically recognized Bears Ears Culture Area, or simply the Bears Ears Area, is the westernmost portion of the northern hemisphere of the San Juan world, sometimes also known as the Mesa Verde region. That's important. As archaeology has progressed upward from consideration solely of artifacts to consideration of sites, to consideration of communities, to consideration of culture areas, and finally to consideration of landscapes and regions, archaeologists have come to appreciate that no accurate portrayal of human socio-cultural anything can be fully understood at less than a regional scale. At the same time, scientific methods have spiraled ever downward in scale, from jars and mummies to tree rings and pollen, to phytoliths and other microscopic crystalline things, to trace elements, to atomic isotopes. To understand the history and cultures of the Bears Ears area, especially during the ancient and slightly more recent pre-contact time periods, it has to be seen in the context of the San Juan region as a whole. This is a running theme in the developing world of American archaeology, and a major sub-theme of this book is the role that Bears Ears has played and continues to play in the story of that development. The other 2 sub-themes are the cultural history of the place itself and the story of my own unlikely involvement there, which interdigitate and converge in a number of intriguing ways. It makes for long chapters, as these 3 sub-themes and the narrative arcs they describe are explored in a gradually tightening weave. But there's a reason. My hope is that telling the human story of the place in such a way will lead the listener into a deeper understanding of why it's so important to so many people. Despite its foundation and reliance on research of a decidedly technical nature, the format and style of this book are more like mainstream wilderness writing than niche academic composition. This, too, is a stylistic departure, or so it might appear. Whether writing for a general audience or for the academy, archaeologists all too often comprise their work of dry technical authorship, dripping with citations and stuffed with incomprehensible jargon that acts as a gauntlet against intruders. Meanwhile, here is Frederick H. Chapin, early American polymath with a penchant for business, mountaineering, photography, and what passed for archaeology in his days, writing about the archaeology of the San Juan region in his book The Land of the Cliff Dwellers back in 1892. The light of noonday floods the walls of the ramparts and penetrates into the deep recesses of the cave. But as the sun sinks westward, a dark shadow creeps across the front of the cavern, and the interior is in deep gloom. It is then that the explorer, standing among the crumbled walls and gazing up at the loopholes above, or following with his eye the course of the canyon down to its end where it joins the greater gorge, wonders what events happened to cause this strong fortress to be deserted or overthrown. Effective public scholarship includes generous scoops of both the entertaining and the humanistic. The only thing that appears to be in short supply in the sciences these days is public scholarship itself. That's especially problematic for archaeology. To my knowledge, no other science has to contend in the public realm with monsters as formidable as Indiana Jones, ancient aliens, and religious and ideological interpretations that span the gamut from annoyingly appropriative to awesomely racist. Compound that with the equally terrifying threat of inadvertently hastening the destruction of archaeological sites by romanticizing and advertising them, and we've got quite a challenge on our hands. Southeastern Utah practically overflows with archaeological relics, including photogenic ones like cliff dwellings. I first read about Cedar Mesa, heartland and crown jewel of the Bears Ears area in terms of archaeology, in David Roberts' In Search of the Old Ones, while working as a seasonal restaurant manager at the north rim of the Grand Canyon. As they did, and still do, with Edward Abbey and the book he wrote about arches, a lot of people have criticized Roberts for writing a little too lovingly about the place he loved so much, thereby exacerbating the subsequent tourist crush. Evidently, what they both should have written was, "This place sucks, just a bunch of rocks, too many goddamn cedar gnats, go to Disney World instead. Maybe some places are just too wonderful to write about?" Maybe. Although I don't see throngs of tourists stampeding all over Jack London's Yukon trying to make friends with wolves. Nor have the copious and impassioned writings of Jacques Cousteau inspired vast hordes of poor swimmers to drown, trying to follow in his flipper wake. But inspiration can't be entirely discounted either. I first learned about Grand Gulch from a book, after all, and then got even more excited about the place when I read Anne Zwinger wax sweetly about it in her own book, Wind in the Rock. According to a handful of sources, a walk in the woods and wild brought unprecedented numbers to the Appalachian and Pacific Crest trails, respectively. Not surprisingly, about half of those sources included cheers and much rejoicing over how the United States still has so much wilderness for people to enjoy, while the other half included foaming snarls and teeth gnashing over the grim specter of overcrowding. I can see both arguments. On the one hand, the great undeveloped outdoors in North America is, and hopefully shall remain, so vast and copious that the notion of its ever getting too dense with visitors borders on derangement. On the other hand, overcrowding is a big problem in the bottleneck areas where people tend to throng like storybook lemmings after they have been pointed out. You can walk the entirety of the Grand Canyon's inner gorge without seeing much more than a handful of other people, for example, but you can't walk 50 yards from the gift shop to the South Rim without seeing much fewer than a gazillion of them. Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot that anyone can do about that. Amazing places invariably attract visitors, and most of them share their experiences with others through one means or another, and so it goes whether we laud or lament. This is especially true in what was supposed to be the space age, but has in fact turned out to be the information age. A time in which secrets aren't really an option anymore, at least not when those secrets are, in a very real sense, just sitting there waiting for the next person to find them. The death of place comes from everywhere eventually. You can whine about it, or you can take steps to mitigate its impacts, but the one thing you can't do is stop it. Moreover, the archaeological splendors of the Bears Ears area have attracted a lot more than just tourists. They attracted some of the earliest of what are very generously called archaeologists back in the late 1800s, followed by a lot more of what are matter-of-factly called looters. The varied natural splendors of the area have also attracted uranium speculators, oil and gas developers, herders of both cattle and sheep, miners, loggers, and, for one brief but lively moment in the late 1990s, armed revolutionary wackos. Long before all that, however, the Bears Ears area attracted people for different reasons. Very different reasons from one era to the next, although whatever that attracting power was, it never wavered. Still hasn't. That attractive element both underscores and precipitates what I consider the most intriguing aspect of the place, a borderlands phenomenon so beautifully expressed there. At almost every given instance in its spectacular prehistory, history, and modernity, the Bears Ears area is the interdigitating limit where different peoples meet, articulate, and assume entirely new and novel socio-cultural expressions within what is operatively a cultural crucible that never cools. Let me say a few more words about prehistory. Like most modern progressive types in the field of anthropology, archaeology being a subfield of anthropology in the U.S., I dislike the term because the prefix pre implies that the people in question have no real history, which is patently ridiculous since literally everything is a result of the history that came before it. The term is arguably racist to boot, depending upon who's using it in reference to whom. In professional usage, it refers to the time period before written history, which in North America means all the stuff that happened before Europeans arrived with parchment and quill. But there's a caveat to even that simple explanation. The Spanish and Spanish-speaking Mexicans aren't often included in it, despite their often copious written accounts. So in the American Southwest, history officially begins after the end of the Mexican-American War in about 1850. All of which seems silly to me, given the astounding temporal stretches chronicled by indigenous oral histories. But alas, it's what I've got to work with. On a related note, throughout this book you will hear non-Western cultures, beliefs, and histories described almost entirely in Western terms. Which sucks, because, as with nutrient energy, you invariably lose a lot of quality when it gets metabolized through alien systems. It simply isn't possible to talk or read about other cultures in terms of your own language and concepts with anything even close to total accuracy. Imagine trying to describe the process of baking bread entirely in terms of boiling soup, and you'll have some idea what I mean. In fact, as Diné politician, scholar, and activist Eric Tashini once pointed out to me, the very concept conveyed by the term culture is itself completely foreign to indigenous North American knowledge systems, let alone that of more loaded terms like nation, tribe, or sacred. Unfortunately, there's only one set of tools in our collective toolbox at present, so it's the one I'm forced to use. But that dejected pronouncement comes with its own caveat. For the reasons just described, knowledge of non-Western peoples that comes wrapped in Western packaging should always be treated as starting points to understanding rather than end points. A foundation, in other words, on which a multiplicity of perspectives might be built, as opposed to a concrete and dogmatic edifice to be venerated on its own. When writing about the place in 1946, Wallace Stegner described southeastern Utah as the heart of our last great wilderness. "This is not real tourist country," he went on to say. And at the time, he wasn't wrong. The first automobile had reached the vicinity of Mexican Hat, at its southernmost extent, in 1921. And in the two decades between that historic event and when Stegner penned his words, very few had followed it. Edward Abbey, always eager to see what his hero Stegner had seen, penetrated into the area in a rattletrap beast in the 1950s, and then immediately began howling about how nobody should ever build a highway into it. The road he took was less than a decade old. Anne Zwinger followed soon after, and although she was never as fierce and ribald as her friend and fellow author Cactus Ed, she also lamented what she knew was coming. The road Abbey took into the area in some of his earliest essays was built in the 1950s to accommodate uranium exploration. The road Anne took a little later to reach Grand Gulch was built to shorten the distance that same uranium had to be hauled. And every scientist, hiker, backpacker, photographer, artist, poet, logger, grazer, weirdo, cop, and grave robber has taken those same roads ever since. On that snowy morning in January of 2017, I took the long but scenic route along one of them to an event celebrating an arduous and ongoing effort to protect the place. In attendance were folks from nearly all the Native American tribes in the region, along with a smattering of white conservationists and other allies like me. Nonprofit groups represented there included Utah Diné Bikaya, Friends of Cedar Mesa, Archaeology Southwest, and Conservation Lands Foundation, all of whom would be co-litigants on a lawsuit filed against the Trump administration when it moved to eviscerate the monument a year later. The speakers were all members of the tribes. Eric Deschini talked about his then-current career as a Diné politician in Phoenix, living far away from his homeland, as well as about how Bears Ears National Monument was an especially symbolic win for women because of the area's feminine healing energy. Navajo Nation Council Delegate Davis Filfred reported being thankful from the bottom of his boots, commenting later on how he'd gotten the council to pass legislation supporting the monument. Sean Chapoose, chairman of the Ute Indian, Uinta Ure Tribe Business Committee, and one of the most fiery speakers I know of, delivered an exceptional polemic about the importance of the monument and how he hoped Trump would be too busy building his great wall to trifle with it. I never tire of that man's wit. The speech that affected me the most, however, was from Regina Lopez Whiteskunk, former Ute Mountain Ute Council member and co-chairwoman of the Bears Ears Intertribal Coalition. We're pals at this point, appearing alongside each other in a number of publications, but I'd never met her before the celebratory gathering in Monument Valley. She recalled being horribly disrespected and ridiculed by the Utah congressional delegation when she and other tribal members testified on Capitol Hill about the urgent need to create elevated protections for the Bears Ears area. As it turned out, she was the first coalition member called when the new monument was designated, and she'd had one hell of a time trying not to blurt the news out to everyone in the world before it was initially announced. It was a touching, and given her treatment by Utah's finest, vindicating story. Regina also emphasized that everyone who knows that place is deeply and invariably moved by it, that we all have our Bears Ears stories as a result, and how she wants to hear each and every one of them. I pondered that as I drove back through the wondrous and towering monoliths of Monument Valley in southeastern Utah, now a shimmering blue from moonlight on snow and ice. It was the honor of a lifetime to be invited to the coalition's event in the first place, to eat the food they served, made with herbs and such that were presciently gathered at Bears Ears the previous fall, and watch them laugh at the coyote pups playing in front of the speakers. This was about the midway point in my own involvement in the conservation battle, and it was about to ramp up in a pretty big way. But that event was, and remains, the most instructive part. This book is my response to Regina's request. Chapter 1. The Mammoth-Killers. The human story of the Bears Ears area begins rather far away from the place itself. So does the story of Bears Ears archaeology. And so, for that matter, does my own. As far as scientists can tell, humans first arrived in the American Southwest no later than about 14,000 years ago, and quite possibly a lot earlier than that. Hypotheses about their methods of arrival vary considerably, although it's clear that people didn't evolve here from our last common ancestor with the other primates. Biological studies point instead to northeastern Asia, and a great many indigenous narratives also include migration from someplace to the north. Exactly how and when have been subjects of ongoing debate for decades, and this has a lot to do with how archaeologists operate. Because it's usually impossible to discern cultures or societies from the purely material record, particularly in cases where all that remain are bones and stone tools, archaeologists typically give typologies or groupings of styles umbrella titles called material cultures, and sometimes artifact complexes or traditions. This approach is useful for building chronologies, but becomes a bit more troublesome when one tries to move from describing things to understanding people. The earliest known artifact tradition in the Americas is the Nenana complex, so-called because of a site found in the Nenana Valley in Alaska, and the people who created it appear to have thrived sometime before and up to about 11,500 years ago. Overlapping this in mainland North America are the Clovis and Western-stemmed traditions, the latter restricted to the Great Basin region of Nevada and western Utah, and the former being found throughout the entirety of North America. This by itself is enough to convince most researchers that the first people to arrive in North America stepped off the boat, or dog sled, or whatever it was, up in modern-day Alaska, and then worked their way downward, the key word being most. These artifact traditions fall into what most American archaeologists call the Paleo-Indian period, which represents adaptations to terminal Pleistocene environments and is characterized by small groups of relative mobile foragers who used most sites only briefly or infrequently. The Paleo-Indian toolkit typically included large lanceolate, long and thin, projectile points, spurred end scrapers, gravers and borers or awls, and in the case of the Western-stemmed tradition, mysterious little crescents that look like fake mustaches. The primary difference among these artifact traditions themselves is the slight variability exhibited in projectile point form, which likely resulted from changing environments and subsistence strategies, but may just as likely have been components of group identity. The Clovis complex takes its name from the site where it was first discovered, when a road crew in eastern New Mexico stumbled upon an assemblage of very large and very old bones, mixed into which were a number of slender, delicate-looking projectile points, about as long as an adult finger. Clovis points are beautiful, intricate, and above all delicate things. Some researchers have looked good and hard at their design, and concluded that they're about as useful against a charging beast the size of a U-Haul as a pocket knife would be against a bulldozer, which means they were either intended as very pretty trade items or as very pretty knives for carving up animals that were already dead, or both, but almost certainly not for spearing live ones. When scientists began using modern radiocarbon dating on Clovis-associated materials, starting with the dead animals with which Clovis points were associated, and moving on to excavated perishable organics, they were delighted to discover that they coincide perfectly with the retreat of the great ice sheets that covered the landmass between mainland North America and northeastern Eurasia roughly 14,000 years ago. The retreat of those glaciers created an ice-free corridor along the Rocky Mountains that channeled the wandering Pleistocene hunter-gatherers into the heart of the continent. Once there, they migrated outward, reaching every nook and cranny in both North and South America within about 500 years, or roughly 1/200th the amount of time it took anatomically modern humans to cross the same distance between our collective homeland in Africa and northwestern Eurasia in the first place. As crazy and unlikely as that sounds, current evidence suggests that it's true. One can only assume the Clovis people were full-time sprinters. Researchers have found and documented something like 10,000 Clovis artifacts, which means there may be as many as 10,000 more lurking in the closets of sticky-fingered ne'er-do-wells. Clovis is known best as the material culture associated with the first people to arrive in mainland North America some 13,000 years ago, the operative word being in quotations because it gets challenged more or less constantly. Mounting evidence shows that people were in the Americas at least a few thousand years before Clovis, further underscoring the unlikelihood of what I call the continental sprinter hypothesis. Confidently dated pre-Clovis sites appear on an almost yearly basis. Most researchers now consider the Clovis first model dead and buried, with many having felt that way for well over a decade at this point, much to the satisfaction of Native American scholars who've doubted/hated it all along. Although this never stops journalists from trotting out the rewrite history meme every time a new one is found. In following with Betteridge's law, anytime you see the clickbaity headline, "Blank could rewrite history," put your money on, but probably not. Betteridge's law. Any headline that ends in a question mark can be answered by the word no. It's named for the British tech journalist Ian Betteridge, although the observation that egregious editorializing should not be taken at face value is about as old as journalism itself. The scientific, historic, and cultural importance of Clovis itself, and the growing number of sites that predate it, cannot be understated. However, apart from one site, and possibly a second, the role that Clovis plays in the Bears Ears area is a small one, so far. Ongoing research hints that there may be more to that story. Following Clovis, the Folsom tradition is also associated with distinctive spear points. They had grooves or flutes that extended from the concave base almost to the very tip, not entirely unlike the blood grooves in some medieval swords, but nearly as wide as the blade itself. The Folsom complex was discovered just over 20 years before the discovery of Clovis, and it also took place in New Mexico. In 1908, a cowboy named George McJunkin, investigating damages to his ranch after a devastating flood that killed 18 people, stumbled across the rib bones of a gigantic bison in an arroyo bed into which the flood had deeply cut. In among the bones were a number of stone tools, including fluted projectile points that look to us now like miniaturized versions of Clovis points, with flared tangs that make them look a bit like Pac-Man ghosts. McJunkin, being no fool, recognized that he was looking at something that might be of interest to archaeologists and, being as careful as possible not to disturb the integrity of the deposits, removed a few sample bones and one of the projectile points and sent them to the Denver Museum of Natural History. It turned out that the bones were those of Bison antiquus, a species of giant bison that had followed woolly mammoths into extinction by 10,000 years ago at the latest. The undeniable temporal connection between those bones and the Native American stone tools jumbled in with them established human antiquity of North America as being at least 9,000 years older than anyone had previously conjectured. The discovery of Clovis a few years later would push it back even further, but Folsom was the game changer. The thing about McJunkin that warrants additional discussion is his ethnicity. He was one of the numerous but largely unsung black cowboys in American Western history. Born into slavery in Texas, he was 9 years old when the Civil War came to an end, and he made his way thence into the world of cowpunching. He was far from alone in this. When freedom for Africans in America finally came about with the 13th Amendment, a large number of them headed west to work as cowhands, because the East was A, full of racists and bad memories, and anyway, B, distinctly lacking in jobs for them outside of porter or elevator operator. Other black people who helped shape the American West during the historic period include Bass Reeves, Robert Smalls, Mary Fields, Nat Love, and Bill Bulldog Pickett, all of whom are worth at least an afternoon of reading and probably a Hollywood film of their own. Paleo-Indian archaeology is sparse throughout the Colorado Plateau, Bears Ears being no exception, and one of the biggest reasons for this is something researchers call taphonomy. This is the process by which an organism is fossilized and the study of what happens to it between its death and subsequent discovery. It's a term coined and used by paleontologists, who actually study fossils, but it's been successfully hijacked by other studiers of natural history, including archaeologists, for their own purposes. Generally speaking, it's the study of site formation with regard to organic physical remains, and in most cases, that means what happens to your bones and belongings after you come a cropper. Taphonomy and its study can best be understood by envisioning a Thanksgiving dinner. These are typically attended by 10 to 20 people of varying ages and about half as many different food items from which to take slices and gobs. There are several dozen ceramic plates and bowls and numerous metal utensils. There are glass drinking cups and paper napkins and so on. There's also a big table, candles on the table, seats around the table, music playing in the background, and sometimes dogs, which will turn out to be important later on, because dogs always are. The feast commences. The feast ends. The things that wind up in the trash are the bones, the soft or gooey items that got scraped off plates because of eyes bigger than stomachs, the napkins and whatever plates, bowls, and glasses happen to break. And then the dogs get into the trash, so most of the organic morsels, and given what I know about dogs, a lot of the napkins, and maybe some of the glass, disappears. What remains goes into the outdoor trash can, at which point a raccoon makes off with the shiny things and whatever bones the dogs couldn't choke down. Come then the birds and insects and grubs and bacteria. By the time the detritus of our hypothesized Thanksgiving feast arrives at its final resting place, it consists of a few turkey leg bones that were too big for any scavengers to handle, and a small pile of broken dishes. And from that, archaeologists are expected to recreate the feast, the family, the setting, the music, and so on. This is the problem of taphonomy. If the feast occurred yesterday, archaeologists could just ask people about it. Testimony would be hazier if it occurred a year or two ago, but photos might exist. 10 years ago, and at least the table and chairs and most of the people themselves are still around, albeit with a dusty sheen on all. But 100 years ago? The furniture has probably been replaced more than once, and most likely the house and the people as well. How about 1,000 years ago? Or 10,000? So part of the reason that Paleo-Indian archaeological materials are so sparse is because Paleo-Indian people were squishy bipeds who didn't drive cars or build skyscrapers, instead relying on animal skins and ephemeral huts and whatever food they managed to collect or clobber with simple tools. Precious little of that is going to endure in open settings for over 100 centuries. And, owing to the process of taphonomy, what does remain is often little more than what you get at the end of our hypothesized Turkey Day trash narrative, a few broken tools and the really big bones. Archaeological literature on Paleo-Indian lifeways has traditionally emphasized big game hunting for this very reason, to the extent of postulating that overexploitation of Pleistocene megafauna that hadn't yet learned to fear humans led directly to the extinction of those animals throughout the continent. This so-called overkill hypothesis has been challenged in more recent literature, and I personally think it's a case of correlation not equaling causation. People were inspired to move great distances into uncharted and potentially very scary places at the same time that these huge and hard-to-feed animals began to die off, after all. So it's much more likely that a lurking variable like climatic pandemonium was the primary impetus of both. The other main reason folks like the ones who left Clovis and Folsom artifacts behind are so often characterized as obligate big game hunters is because Paleo-Indian-associated artifacts most often occur in lower elevations along major river valleys, where Pleistocene megafauna liked to congregate. This includes the original Clovis site itself in Blackwater Draw, New Mexico. But water is a pretty good place to congregate. I would be more surprised to find that the artifacts of a hunting and gathering people most often occur, say, on the tops of mountains. And, as of this writing, only about a dozen kill sites are known from the entire Clovis assemblage continent-wide. So I'd hardly say they were leaning on hunted megafauna as the sole meat component of their respective meat and potatoes. Behavioral ecologists, in other words, people who study the ways in which environment and behavior have shaped one another in human and other animal species, have pretty well demolished the idea that Clovis people were obligate megafauna hunters. A diet consisting primarily of meat is a hard sell for the human body right out of the gate, although humans are amazingly adaptive and our diets can be highly variable depending on our local environments. The Inuit people, for example, really do eat a diet of almost nothing but fatty animal bits. But look where they live. Besides which, they always target and savor the half-digested vegetables in those animals' stomachs, and narwhal skin has been found to contain more vitamin C than citrus fruit. So, yeah, it's possible for people to subsist on a diet consisting primarily of meat, but only after many generations of adaptation to rather extreme circumstances. And in any event, that doesn't typically include the meat of trumpeting Goliaths. Not that scavenging or hunting of megafauna never happened, of course. Confirmed mammoth kills by Paleo-Indian people are less common than one might think, but it's still a lot more than zero. It's the obligate part that's problematic. The one confirmed Clovis site in the entire Bears Ears area is a hunting camp located not far to the west of Bluff, a colorful community situated on the San Juan River that only recently, after nearly 240 years, became incorporated as a town. The site is located near the San Juan River, which is indeed where you would expect to find Pleistocene megafauna, but also where you'd find plants, fish, ducks, and, water. It's basically an assemblage of stone tools and the abundant little chips of stone residue from making them, what archaeologists call a lithic scatter. Most archaeological sites in the United States in toto are lithic scatters. This is primarily because they don't erode or decay like perishable organic things, and because sticky-fingered visitors are unlikely to collect pocketfuls of the archaeological equivalent of what a colleague of mine once described as pencil-sharpening shavings. Although it's also because stone tools were a fantastic idea when human beings first invented them, and remained so for a very, very long time. As retired university professor James O'Connell once explained it to me, a good sharp edge is ideal for two purposes, opening animals and closing arguments. That's it for confirmed Clovis sites in the Bears Ears area. There aren't any fulsome sites until you get nearer to the town of Moab, well into the northeast, most likely because there weren't any bison. Bison were to Folsom Complex foragers what gold is to Tolkien dwarves. There's effectively no finding the latter unless there's a lot of the former. But confirmed is a tricky word in this case. Also to the west of Bluff is a rock art panel that supposedly contains at least one and possibly two mammoths. Although if you look at the mammoth from almost any angle other than the one prescribed by its recorders, it looks more like a dog, or an aardvark, or an antelope with a snout, or a kangaroo, or a unicorn, or a 2004 Chevy Silverado, or almost anything else your mind can imagine. You'll find that's a common problem with the study of rock art. Sometime between its creation and eventual discovery, an errant boulder strikes a petroglyph panel just so, and subsequent hordes of experts spill bounteous ink and bile over the question of whether or not the people who carved it were involved in a cult that worshipped flying mushrooms. Having said all that, I spend a lot of time looking at rock art, or rock writing as my Hopi friends prefer to call it, and that supposed mammoth really does look awfully mammoth-like to me. So who knows? At any rate, the controversy over whether or not it's genuine is a fun one. It was discovered by genial and popular local artist Joe Patchick, who was often hired and/or volunteered to apply his considerable artistic skill to recording local archaeological petroglyph, pecked in, and pictograph, painted on, panels. Whilst so engaged in 2011, he spotted what he believed to be a petroglyph depicting a Colombian mammoth, one of two species of woolly mammoth formerly endemic to North America, and arguably the older of the two, superimposed with what also appeared to be a Pleistocene bison. Joe knew he'd found something big and quickly got on the horn to professional archaeologists so they could come and have a look. Their conclusion? The panel does indeed depict a Pleistocene mammoth and bison, dating about 13,000 to 11,000 years ago. In the community of Bluff, there was much rejoicing. Briefly. Voices of dissent in the archaeological and paleontological communities popped up almost immediately. The most reliably dated mammoths in North America all date to before about 11,000 years ago. Although the Huntington mammoth, so called for its discovery near Huntington, Utah, a rural community 200 or so miles north of Bears Ears, is presumed to have died no more than 10,500 years ago. It has been called the last holdout of the mammoth extinction by its discoverer, paleontologist David Gillette. But it also lived and died near a boggy and densely vegetated lakeshore, where chewy greens were plentiful. There is zero evidence of mammoths and people living together in the much more xeric Bears Ears area, Although if the folks at the Clovis site west of Bluff had migrated south through Huntington, there was at least one they might have spotted along the way. Dating petroglyphs is also notoriously difficult. They are often just lines scratched and hammered into rock, after all. There is nothing to date. Researchers have weighed in on the subject in a variety of public forums. A particularly intriguing hypothesis has been advanced by noted local archaeologist Winston Hurst, who remains agnostic but hopeful, which suggests that maybe the timing isn't all that important because people talk about, think about, and depict things out of time all the time. This is part of the reason that storytelling was invented, after all. The associated notion of cultural memory is one in which important or sacred images, stories, and songs are so vividly passed along that recipients can interpret them with considerable accuracy many generations later. We aren't very good at this these days because our technophilic culture has done to our attention spans what a belt sander does to a crayon. I can't even remember phone numbers anymore now that I've got a device in my pocket that does it for me. But if it was a matter of retain complicated information with precision or you'll stumble into a very unpleasant death, I'm betting we could still do it. Furthermore, there is plentiful evidence to suggest that people living in the Bears Ears area during ancient times were well aware of how things went down in more ancient times. And here, too, Clovis comes into the picture. In the spring of 2017, a school teacher was ambling around on top of Cedar Mesa when she stumbled upon a beautiful and seemingly flawless Clovis point. That's crazier than you might imagine. I know people who've devoted entire careers to studying the Paleo-Indian era that haven't seen a Clovis point in the wild, let alone one that's in pristine condition. My current employers, as of this writing, have a standing offer of a keg of good beer or a bottle of decent wine for the first person who finds a complete Clovis point on the job, and there's little to no chance it will ever be claimed. Thankfully, she did the right thing. After presumably freaking out with joy, she left it exactly where it was and informed Bureau of Land Management, BLM archaeologist Don Simonis. It turns out that the point was probably curated by an ancestral Pueblo, circa 1500 BC to AD 1492, individual or family, and was made from the beautiful tiger-striped alabates chert that occurs in Texas and Oklahoma. Clovis points made from alabates chert are found all over the country. They were the Toledo steel or Fabergé eggs of their time, in that they were highly distinctive of the place where they were made and essentially impossible to fake with local materials. This is what makes the tale of the Clovis point from Cedar Mesa so heartwarming. It's fair to say that a fair number of individuals who stumbled across a stunning Clovis point during a hike would now have a sweet souvenir in their sock drawer. Plus, amoral thieving swine aside, even moving the thing 20 feet from where it was found in order to hide it safely under a rock would have destroyed its invaluable contextual integrity. The fact that it was found in an ancestral Pueblo artifact scatter tells the story of how and why it got there. Move it just a few yards this way or that, and the factual storyline is broken. Fittingly enough, it is during this earliest of material culture chronology that we get our first glimpse of what I consider to be the most incredible and noteworthy aspect of the human history of the Bears Ears area. Called various things by various authors, what I prefer to call the borderlands phenomenon in social science is the textured and fluctuating patterns of collision, conflict, and coalescence of different cultural groups in the places where the fringes of their respective territories overlap or interdigitate. These are the forges of culture, often the birthing places of new and unique ones that spring forth from all that elbow rubbing. Because these are the peripheral or backwoods portions of their total occupational footprints, far away from what social scientists call the cultural core, it's where you'll most often get a unique blend of both overt self-identification and fierce, sometimes zealous group loyalty. And it makes a lot of sense to me, too. I grew up in a mobile home community, which I'm told is the nouveau PC term for trailer park, which was just far enough outside of suburbia to be considered rural. Roughly half of my friends were independent-minded to the point that they regularly denounced their U.S. citizenship. often very loudly and usually at keg parties, just as often as they denounced loyalty to our school district, and they were the ones who routinely dated students from other ones. The other half, the ones you more often see on television these days, were some of the most frenetically patriotic human beings I've ever seen. Patriotic in terms of our school district, with concomitant hatred for its rivals, but also in terms of our country as a whole. What this suggests is that the farther a community is from its cultural core, the deeper it is in the hinterlands where people from other groups might be encountered, the more often people fracture into those who cling as desperately as possible to their respective group identity and those who readily jettison it in order to explore what those others might have to offer. Jesse Toon, one of my fellow newer generation archaeologists and now an assistant professor at Fort Lewis College in Durango, has studied the Paleo-Indian period in the greater Bears Ears area for several years. Based on determining the geographic sources of much of the isolated lithic tools found in paleo sites across the region, using both stylistic cues and fancy microscopic science, he's found that people came to the area from at least three different origination points: the Great Basin, the desert southwest, and the Rockies. Once there, subtle but distinctly local patterns and styles began to emerge that Toon is only just beginning to tease out of the material record. What drew them to the Bears Ears area in the first place is uncertain, given its signal paucity of mammoths, although again, the idea that they were only subsisting on hunted megafauna has been scientifically challenged on the grounds of being moronic. If you ask members of the indigenous community, especially the tribes most closely associated with Bears Ears, they'll almost always report that it makes a lot of sense to them because it's the place. Axis Mundi and Ultima Thule in a single spectacular package. I can't exactly argue with that. It drew me across an entire continent before I'd even seen it on a map. Although one of the major threads of this book is the development of Southwest archaeology vis-a-vis the Bears Ears area, it's useful to lay out the earliest iterations of archaeology as a whole, which, like the area's human story, begins rather far away. American archaeology differs most significantly from that practiced across the pond in that it's a branch of anthropology instead of history. Functionally speaking, history deals with figuring out what happened in the past, where and by whom, in order to reconstruct it into a timeline or narrative. Anthropology is a branch of science concerned with figuring out the nuts and bolts of human behavior, the reasons that we look and act how we do. In other words, history is the who, what, where, and when of the past. Anthropology is the how and the why. In the American Southwest, the act of suturing the two together commenced about as soon as archaeology itself did, with the earliest archaeologists not only making trait lists and chronologies, but also investigating the extant indigenous community to try to make sense of past versions of those same things. The torch was enlarged in the 1950s by researchers who complained that archaeological historians were too dry and boring, and became ablaze with the new archaeology of the 1960s and 70s and its emphasis on archaeology as a science. Elsewhere on the spectrum of anthropology, the practice of observing the behaviors and characteristics of human beings that haven't died yet is called ethnography, from the root words ethno, relating to race or culture, and graph, to write. It is the cataloging of cultural traits, in other words, the investigation and interpretation of which is called ethnology. This is where American archaeology does have an advantage, if pressed in the right way, over methods and practices of archaeology that aren't anthropologically informed. Understanding the human past can only be accomplished with any sort of intellectual integrity by understanding the human present, and to a certain extent, the opposite is also true. The most important thing to remember about ancient people is that they were people. Curiosity about the human past appears to be a human universal, as evidenced by the Clovis point found in an ancestral Pueblo site atop Cedar Mesa. One of the earliest acts of what could tentatively be called proto-archaeology took place in New Kingdom, Egypt, roughly 1150 to 1070 BC, or right around 3,000 years ago, when one of the pharaohs ordered the excavation and reconstruction of the Sphinx, its having been originally constructed about 1,000 years earlier and devoured by the desert in the interim. This tying of present cultures to past ones in order to reclaim some proud earlier glory, underscore local rights and affiliations, or otherwise associate a current society with a past one, pops up all over the temporal and geographic human world. Take the Aztecs. The great city-state of Teotihuacan rose and fell in the Valley of Mexico between about AD 300 and 1150, and in its prime it was the largest city in the pre-colonized Americas, with an estimated population of 200,000. Its influence can be seen in areas as far as 1,000 miles away. Then a revolution took place, following what the material evidence indicates was a vicious famine as a result of climate change in the early AD 500s, and most of the place was burned to the ground, particularly religious centers and homes of the fat and wealthy, as often occurs in revolutions, before being abandoned. Almost 1,000 years later, the Aztecs decided the crumbling ruins were a sacred place where the world was created and gave it its name. Teotihuacan means City of the Gods in Nahuatl, the language of the Aztecs. We have no idea what it was called by its actual occupants. For that matter, the word Aztec is actually a shortening of the Nahuatl phrase Aztecatl, meaning person from Aztlan, their cultural place of origin. The Aztecs modeled much of their architecture, artwork, and other civic accoutrements after those of the Teotihuacanos, in much the same way that the United States models a lot of its own public architecture and other civic characteristics after those of Imperial Rome. And not entirely unlike the ancient city-state they came to worship, the Aztecs' own imperialistic majesty eventually nosedived into a whole lot of public butchery and other heinousness not long before the Spanish showed up to make things even worse. The Romans fared a little better, but I'm sure we'll be fine. Skipping forward a bit, professional interest in the prehistory of the Southwest commenced not long after the end of the Mexican-American War of 1846 to 1848, and for the ostensive purpose of refuting the idea that the Southwest was the ancestral home of the Aztecs. Pioneering early archaeologists thereby provided data supporting the contention that our Southwest was not significantly related to their Mexican past. Although this doffs its own hat to the thorny issue of how both countries felt about their respective indigenous peoples. This is why you'll find a Montezuma Creek in Utah, an Aztec ruin in northern New Mexico, and a Montezuma Castle and Well in central Arizona. American archaeology really begins with what is generally and generously called antiquarianism, a social movement among the European wealthy that swirled around an obsession with ancient sites, manuscripts, and artifacts. Its roots are hazy, but it was a recognizable thing by the 1500s. These were hobbyists rather than scholars who amassed collections of historic curios for display in their homes in much the same way as modern hunters with their taxidermy menageries. And today we wouldn't call them antiquarians so much as goddamn thieves. But they had this going for them. The antiquarian movement made much of the importance of human material history as a subset of natural history. In the 1500s, the importance of secular study of the past ramped up considerably, including the creation of King's Antiquary as an official role played by scholars starting in 1533. As with the Aztecs and the New Kingdom pharaohs, the principal component of their task was to gather materials and investigate genealogies and other evidences about the history of their respective kingdom in order to add some polish to their boisterous historical claims. None of the antiquarians were interested in prehistory, of course. The Bible told them everything they might want to know about history going all the way back to the beginning of the universe, calculated by theologian and logician Archbishop Usher, in 1650 as having taken place on October 23rd of 4004 BC, presumably at just the right time in the morning that the sudden appearance of a sun wouldn't freak anybody out. They were entirely focused on more recent history. During the Enlightenment, or roughly the entire 1700s, the intrigue of the past as a means for rich people to gather baubles and royally appointed scholars to piece together fun facts about everything leading up to the great and glorious present began losing ground to the larval form of modern science. The discovery of deep time, that is, geologic time, by James Hutton in the latter portion of the century got other intellectuals into a tizzy about what might be lurking in the suddenly enormous stretch of pre-recent history. The deeply religious continued to insist that the universe was created in October of 4004 BC, with those of slightly shallower zeal having doubts about this, but still maintaining that millions of years was simply out of the question. But the Age of Enlightenment isn't called what it is for no reason, and the secular contention spread like wildfire. By the time the United States split from Europe and began manifesting its destiny across the continent, most people were fairly certain that world history extended considerably further back in time than 4004 BC. Enlightenment thinkers, particularly the French, also armed some of the earliest archaeologists with a concept of social change and progress more firmly rooted in naturalistic rather than overtly religious convictions. Where before everyone just assumed that they were God's chosen people and naturally also assumed that everyone else was lying when they said the exact same thing, scholars and philosophers began studying processes of gradual change that seemed more likely to have developed into the status quo over time. The assumption of progress itself was still a given, of course. No European intellectuals would dare presume that the brutes who preceded them were on anything like the same level of development as they were. And that presumption, that evolution is synonymous with progress, is a meme that results in many headaches in academic circles to this day. But it was a start, at least. Meanwhile, the juxtaposed philosophies of progress and gradual naturalistic change had undergone their own symbiotic evolution in the study of the human condition, especially following publication of Darwin's On the Origin of Species and the Descent of Man. Lewis Henry Morgan, considered by many to be the father of American anthropology, espoused in the late 1800s a theory of social evolution that postulated three stages in human socio-cultural development: savagery, barbarism, and civilization. These were further subdivided and delineated by technological innovations, such as the discovery of fire, the development of agriculture and writing, domestication of animals, and so on. In this unilineal or teleological, they both mean proceeding in only one direction, like a train on a set of tracks, model is another example of the problem of conflating evolution with progress. And it came with its own set of headaches that bedevil professors of anthropology even now. Moreover, such rigidly unilineal thinking begets an associated rigidity of thinking itself, such that Morgan was absolutely convinced that no politically complex systems had ever occurred in the Americas. How could they? You can get civilized people acting like barbarians sometimes, but you won't find barbarians doing things that only civilized people can do. The underlying scenario that still fertilizes that sort of sectarian misconception is an endogamous dilemma that doesn't often dog our European counterparts. The majority of archaeologists and anthropologists in the United States are white, and most of the people, past or present, that they study are very definitely not. This, too, is starting to shift. I'd need two or three extra sets of hands to count all the non-Anglo archaeologists with whom I've worked in recent years. But they're still far fewer in number, by at least an order of magnitude. And the harshest perception engendered by this disparity is that archaeology is simply a fancy scientific form of colonialism, the relegation of America's indigenous past into books and museum displays, while Native Americans themselves are relegated to Skid Row. Although it is worth pointing out that some of the earliest anthropologists in general, including a few archaeologists in particular, had their hearts in the right places and were simply trying to mitigate the widespread cultural and physical genocide of indigenous cultures by seeking to at least preserve their memory. The combined forces of progress and evil are driving these people into extinction, they reasoned, so we'd better at least do them the honor of giving them and their cultures functionally permanent remembrance before both are snuffed out. Adolf Bandelier, although a keen student of Morgan, was arguably a member of this club. Where he is known at all, Bandelier is known best for two things: the national monument due south of Bear's Ears in New Mexico that bears his name, and his ancestral Pueblo historical fiction called The Delightmakers. But he was also instrumental in the intellectual battle against the ignoble forces that insisted the architectural splendors of places like Mesa Verde and Chaco, neither of which he ever got a chance to visit, were made by the Aztecs just before they fled south to Mexico. He openly balked at any specious pie-in-the-sky hypotheses about the archaeology of the Southwest that involved lost Phoenicians, Israeli tribesmen, and the like. If Bandelier had heard the ancient aliens crowd, who hypothesize literal saucers in the sky, he would have choked on his tea. Bandelier was no romantic. In fact, he seemed to despise romantics. But he was eager to give readers a thorough glance at what Pueblo history supposedly looked like before its modern iterations vanished for good. The rest of the time, however, anthropologists were busily collecting data in order to scientifically demarcate social categories that functionally justified larger-scale efforts to eradicate indigenous peoples from lands that would be better utilized by better peoples, which is to say, themselves. For all that, he deserves credit as an explorer and early conservationist par excellence. John Wesley Powell serves as a useful example of this. Like Bandelier, he was also an avid student of the teachings of Lewis Henry Morgan and his unilineal model of cultural evolution, sometimes called social Darwinism, to my annoyance. Darwin's hand-drawn schematics look like bushes rather than ladders for a reason. Evolutionary adaptation does not progress in a single direction according to some predetermined design. It bounces around at random, like a ball in a tumble dryer, getting stuck into a pattern whenever a particular design confers benefits in a particular environment. Change the environment and the design becomes a flaw. That's the limiting factor of nature. The only place where the law of the jungle is actually lawless is in our flimsy and corruptible legal systems. Powell's extensive and rather impressive ethnographic investigations nonetheless add up to a massive effort to catalog and examine all the features that set Native Americans above the level of Morganian savages, but still firmly below that of civilized Europeans. My own Bear's Ears story starts a little closer to the place itself than do those of its human history and role in Southwest archaeology, but it's still a schlep. I was born and raised in upstate New York, which I often consider to be part of Greater New England, owing to a distinct contiguity of gray skies, cows, and Dunkin' Donuts. We lived in the borderlands between what was firmly suburbia and what was firmly the sticks. Outside of reading way too much H.P. Lovecraft and Edgar Allan Poe than any normal child should, my pastime activities as a youth included riding four-wheelers through the woods with my best friend, drinking illegally acquired beer, and blasting guns at absolutely everything, helping said friend and his father fix cars and chop wood, and ferociously hating any and all self-righteous blowhard liberals. The fact that I grew up to be what I am today underscores the fact that origin is not always tantamount to destiny. Growing up with little else to distract me, the old moss-enshrouded cemeteries and numerous abandoned buildings of the New England region became just as much a fixture as ATVs and woodpiles. My best friend in those days was a country boy comrade named Dan, who had the good luck to live on the rural side of the border that delineated our respective school districts. My family resided just over the suburban side, which meant I got to deal with that during grade school while he was surrounded by kids a lot more like us, which, in retrospect, created its own set of problems. He was, in his own words, an ignorant redneck and damn proud of it, but in private, he loved nothing so much as a good book. He introduced me to J.R.R. Tolkien when I was about 14, which is not a discovery one expects to make in the hayloft of a cobwebby barn. Serendipitous happenstance of that sort isn't altogether uncommon in my life, and I suspect that's true of a lot of people's lives if they'd just take a moment to notice it. To give one other example of this, if you're at all familiar with the syndicated comics BC or The Wizard of Id, you'll know they were created over half a century ago by Johnny Hart. His grandson, Mason Mastroianni, was a couple years ahead of me in high school, and he remains the most incredibly gifted artist I've ever met. Mason and I were among the small cadre of social outcasts who could often be found sitting in the art room drawing while the other kids were off playing sports or pawing at each other. I ended up being better at writing, as it turns out. But to quote Aesop Rock, I used to draw. Bigger than his talents, however, is Mason's heart. His family bought him several cars while he was a student, and he was remarkably generous when it came to their use, especially toward poor kids like me. After attending the country's premier art schools and landing a gig in the new world of Hollywood CGI, Mason's big-heartedness became known to the world when he quit what was probably a very lucrative Tinseltown career. This was before CGI tech started getting mightily screwed over by big production firms, or so I'm given to understand, for the much humbler one of newspaper cartoonist after his grandfather passed away in 2007. Mason has been drawing BC ever since. He assumed the controls to The Wizard of Id in 2015. Mutual friends occasionally crack jokes about how Mason grew up to draw fake people from antiquity and I grew up to study the real ones. Given some of my childhood pastimes, it's a little less surprising to me. Exploring all things derelict and decrepit climbed steadily up the list for my rural bestie and I, as we searched further and further afield for fun distractions from the everyday and mundane. Dan's family owned a few three-wheelers that helped with these explorations on occasion, but mostly we crept around on foot. I guess that's probably how I got into hiking. There's a lot of physical history in the greater New England region if one knows where to look, although a lot of it is notably decadent in nature. Take cemeteries. While early Euro-American settlers in the Northeast built most of their homes out of trees, while clear-cutting the entire eastern seaboard, the wet and verdant climate rotted most of those away within a generation or two. Stone walls endure, as do a few stone structures, but they're rare outside of major settlements that are still occupied. This is our old friend taphonomy at work again. But cemeteries were fairly common, given how eponymously religious the Puritans were. And gravestones are called gravestones for a reason. Thus, if you wander around in the northeastern woods long enough, you're going to stumble across one or two of them. This did little to assuage the already formidable association between the Northeast and gloom that I'd developed, thanks to Lovecraft and Poe, but it also gave my fellow country lad and I something to look for. Finding an abandoned house or farmstead was always cool, but they tended not to be very old, and anyway, there was always the chance of disturbing the sort of squatters you really don't want to disturb. But graveyards, including old ones with antiquated designs like winged skulls on the stones, those were always fun to find. They occupied a lot of our wandering attentions in those earliest days. Sex, drugs, and Dungeons and Dragons would eventually usurp a lot of that flailing adventurousness, as they often do for people in their later teens, given some variability on that third component. But exploring abandoned places remained a fixture for me and for him, right up until his untimely death in 2016. I think we were always searching for our real homes, and the idée fixe for both of us was a paradoxical place where sunlight and shadows both abound. I would find mine in the deep, winding, wondrous canyons of the northern Southwest. Some never do. Chapter 2. The Foragers. While the earliest archaeologists are little distinguishable from treasure hunters, the development of archaeology as a science began in the form of history reconstruction. In broad strokes, history is the sequence of events that took place in the past within a given area. Thus, reconstructing local history from the material residue left behind by past peoples is just a matter of determining what happened, by whom, and in what order. Easy, right? In the developing world of Southwest archaeology, folks seeking to make sense of the archaeological record often sought to do so in the creation of various sequential schema or occupation histories that could fit neatly along a linear timeline. These were the culture history archaeologists, as we refer to them, although I've always thought material culture archaeologists would be a better title. They looked at trends in the material residue, decided upon what they saw as significant patterns, for example, these people ate a lot of pork, and then affixed to these nebulous groupings a cultural title befitting that observation. We'll call them the pig eaters. Thus, in the Southwest, the people who made baskets but not ceramics became known as basket makers, later condensed into one word, basket makers. And the ones who lived in what the Spanish called pueblos became known as pueblo people, their predecessors now called ancestral pueblo for this reason, although for a long time before that, they were all called cliff dwellers because some of them did indeed dwell in cliffs. Long before them roamed the supposed big game specialists during the Paleo-Indian, literally very old Indian, period. I shall have much more to say about these classificatory pigeonholes as this story unfolds, but for now it's enough to have that as a basis. The progenitors of that basis, represented principally by A.V. Kidder at the first ever Pecos Archaeological Conference in 1927, recognized that there must be some transitional phase between the spear-hurling Paleo-Indians and the crop-growing ancestral Pueblo peoples. Richard Wetherill provided one of the missing links in the form of the basket-maker farmers he investigated in the Bears Ears area, but even that seemed a far leap from mammoth gristle. Kidder, in particular, insisted that there must have been a culture phase that was pre-agricultural, yet adumbrating later developments. Adumbrate means outline, by the way. This postulated culture phase was dubbed Basket Maker 1, with the subsequent phase thereby getting the title Basket Maker 2, and all was over bar the finding of actual evidence of its existence. Nobody ever did. There were contenders, though, and when researchers began to recognize material components during the 1940s and 50s that fit these criteria, pre-ceramic, pre-agricultural, non-Paleo-Indian, for some reason, the title of Basket Maker 1 wasn't applied to them. This is most likely because they didn't find any baskets. I'm not kidding about that. Instead, these sites that consisted of older than basket maker but smaller than paleo stone artifacts were corralled into local cultures or complexes with names like San Jose, Cochise, Picosa, and because the late Jesse Jennings was nothing if not a pragmatist, desert culture. The term archaic, which usually means outdated in popular usage, was introduced as an umbrella name in a foundational 1958 paper, and that's the one that stuck. The archaic period spans approximately 10,000 to 2,500 years before present, or BP, which actually means before 1950 rather than before today, because nuclear weapons testing and similar shenanigans have mucked up the background radiocarbon signal in our environment since about that time. Most researchers further divide the archaic into four sub-periods: early, approximately 10,000 to 8,000 BP, middle, 8,000 to 5,000 BP, late, 5,000 to 3,000 BP, and terminal, 3,000 to 2,500 BP. Although most Southwest researchers lump the terminal archaic into the earliest formative period on account of the appearance of farming. The early archaic encompasses most of the early and middle Holocene, the geological epoch in which we currently dwell, during the altothermal climactic period, a stretch of about 4,000 years when the summer temperature throughout western North America was considerably warmer than today. For basically the entire intermountain West, including the Colorado Plateau, environmental changes during this period have been particularly well documented in some of the dry caves of the Great Basin, where relative abundances of plant and animal remains can be read like a census. Pinyon pine approached its modern distribution during this period, or started to anyway, which is fun to think about because most people seldom realize that trees can and do migrate. It happens so slowly that it escapes our notice. When glaciers expanded across the northern portions of the Americas and Eurasia during the last ice age, a lot of plants fled south. Many of them were crushed against the Alps in Europe, being plants and having no ability to fly over or tunnel beneath them. But in North America, there were no such impediments, so they just kept marching south. When the glaciers retreated, the trees turned around and started the ponderous journey home, although in some cases it wasn't ponderous as much as explosive. The coincidentally named ponderosa pine experienced one of the most extensive and least ponderous post-glacial expansions of any tree community in the world, which is why you can now walk under a virtually unbroken canopy of pondi boughs from Flagstaff around the Grand Canyon, across the Colorado Plateau, and then upward along the Rockies into Canada. Meanwhile, the arid altithermal period effectively dried all the major lake systems of Nevada and Utah, leaving a conspicuous bathtub ring on the geology surrounding the shores of once mighty Pleistocene lakes like Bonneville. By about 8,000 years ago, pinyon pines expanded into newly xeric environmental niches to occupy most of the places they still occupy, like Cedar Mesa. With changing climates came the expansion and modification of artifact assemblages as people adapted to a wider, more dispersed plant and animal resource base. That expansion was, at least in part, a product of adjusting to the altithermal dryness and the death toll it wreaked on producer-consumer communities in the West. Drought spirals upward, after all, taking its biggest toll on those species with the biggest appetites. When there isn't enough grass to feed big animals like deer and other ungulates, they get replaced by smaller, fleeter ones that require fewer leaves to power them along, like rabbits. This is confirmed in the archaeological record by low abundances of ungulate remains during the early and middle Holocene, suggesting that large terrestrial mammals were rare during this time. If the woolly mammoths and other huge mammals of the North American Ice Age hadn't died out long before, the altithermal would have gotten them. Continuing the trend that began during the later Paleo-Indian period, higher elevation settings were used even more frequently during the early Archaic, probably representing further generalization of subsistence strategies. Which makes sense. You wouldn't catch me straddling some perilous crag in search of suspect comestibles if turkey sandwiches are still plentiful in the valley below. This was the dawning of the age of broad-spectrum foraging, which is fancy talk for hunting and gathering for increasingly diverse stuff. The Middle Archaic period spans the remainder of the mid-Holocene, during which the climate continued to be generally warm and dry. People used more or less the same projectile points as they did in the early Archaic, which is annoying because distinctive styles of projectile points, meaning spear or arrowheads, are almost the only artifacts to which field workers can ascribe any temporality before ceramics come along. Decades of research into why projectile point typology looks the way it does has added up to a big beats us in terms of functionality beyond the simple and obvious, like how arrowheads are smaller than spearheads because arrows are smaller than spears. Otherwise, the variability of their shapes neither adds nor deletes any significant advantages. The best we can surmise is that they were probably cultural markers, although this too is problematic. The Elko side or corner-notched projectile point, for example, first appears in the early Archaic, dominates artifact assemblages during the Middle Archaic, and then holds steady at a low rumble right up until about the year AD 1000. That's over 7,000 years. That makes the notion of an Elko culture a bit hard to swallow. In addition to Elko series projectile points being all the rage, a slight increase in the frequency of grinding stones during the Middle Archaic seems to indicate a stronger reliance on plant resources than in previous periods. But the big word in the Middle Archaic is mobility. Middle Holocene environmental changes reconfigured the spatial and temporal distribution of resources that were important to earlier occupants of the region, as in the shifting and shuffling of plant communities. I was on top of Cedar Mesa with legendary local hiking guide and Friends of Cedar Mesa board president Vaughn Haydenfelt a few years ago when he spotted a gorgeous Middle Archaic projectile point. That was it. Just the point. The only sites we know from this period appear in a highly obscure 1959 report in El Palacio, magazine of the Museum of New Mexico. A team of archaeologists working on a salvage project found a total of 5 sites on a low mesa just north of the San Juan River, near the town of Aneth, and all of them were artifact scatters with no domestic components. So, people were definitely in the vicinity of Bear's Ears during the Middle Archaic, although probably not in festival-sized crowds. The beginning of the Late Archaic coincides roughly with the time when the climate began to approach what we think of as modern conditions. With the cooler and generally more hospitable climate of the late Holocene, the density of large mammal populations rebounded significantly, and large mammal bits become a lot more common in archaeological assemblages. Archaeological evidence indicates that nearly every available resource in nearly every available place was in use. Serendipitously, at least for archaeologists, late archaic peoples more often lived in rock shelters than did more mobile earlier groups, where the dry atmosphere preserved an array of perishable items like baskets, mats, and sandals. The late archaic was also a time of trade in exotic or hard-to-find items like obsidian, turquoise, and marine shells, the first two of which can be sourced back to the locations of manufacture using high-tech analysis, while the last can be sourced to the ocean, because that's where marine shells are from. Finally, throughout much of the Colorado Plateau, the archaeology dating to the tail end of the late archaic is one of increasing sedentism, as people started settling down for a bit of farming. The question of whether late archaic foragers learned and adopted farming in situ, or were replaced by incoming farmers from elsewhere, in other words, whether it was cultural transmission of knowledge or migration of actual people, is ongoing. But the Bear's Ears area offers a tantalizing clue. Old Man Cave is a dry shelter located on the northeastern edge of Cedar Mesa, where early agricultural materials were discovered in the late 1800s. Subsequent re-examination of the site revealed that it was looted in recent years, because of course it was, but archaic cultural materials were nonetheless evident in the churned-up deposits underlying the agricultural ones. An open twined sandal, characteristic of earlier archaic varieties, returned a radiocarbon age of 7,440 plus or minus 100 years ago, setting a presumed baseline for initial occupation, and additional subsurface testing yielded six more dates from charcoal, grass chaff, and rodent feces. Based on all these data, it appears that the cave was steadily occupied for a whopping 1,000 years before going unused for another 6,000 or so, after which it was reoccupied for an indeterminate spell. That big hiatus suggests that it wasn't knowledge about farming that moved into the area, but farmers themselves. Dating archaic period sites can be just as challenging as dating Paleo-Indian sites, owing to their general paucity of organic materials. In the Moab area to the north, Squaw Park Cave has been dated to the archaic period in general, and several sites in Ten Mile Wash have been dated to the Middle Archaic period in particular. In the Bear's Ears area, the current frontrunner for studying and understanding archaic period lifeways on a landscape level is Dark Canyon. Dark Canyon is the most appropriately named place in all of Bear's Ears. Deep, dark, and all but inaccessible for about half the year, it was originally called Vega Canyon, for reasons I've never been able to ascertain. Dark Canyon and its major tributaries comprise a 76.3 square mile wilderness area. The environmental character of the place is such that conducting extensive archaeological studies there is a grim affair. Water abounds, but the springs themselves are widely spaced, and the complex terrain makes it impossible to access the canyon bottoms and all but the Peavine Canyon corridor using anything but feet or hooves. Food, camping, and cooking gear and all scientific and safety implements must be hauled around on human or horseback. Every year since 2005, a team of 10 to 12 volunteers from the nonprofit Wilderness Volunteers has accompanied district archaeologist Don Irwin and a rotating cast of seasonal employees, like me, on a week-long effort to conduct survey, monitoring, and site recordation in the Dark Canyon wilderness. After 12 years of three or four small teams working diligently on systematic pedestrian surveys for a week at a time, they've managed to inventory about 4% of the main and tributary canyon systems. It's a big place. Based on these data, we now know that Dark Canyon Wilderness was at least lightly or moderately utilized during every phase of local occupation, from early archaic through to this morning. However, the overwhelming bulk of occupation there appears to be bimodally distributed between archaic and late Pueblo sites, with appreciably more of the former. And then there's the ubiquitous, to me anyway, topic of bear's ears as a cauldron of cultural coalescence. In an article he wrote for Archaeology Southwest magazine, Irwin reports that the archaic artifact assemblages in Dark Canyon include projectile points from the Southern Colorado Plateau, or Oshara tradition, and the Northern Colorado Plateau tradition. This distinction between northern and southern variants in the archaic material cultures of the Colorado Plateau also occurs with sandals. So it's more than a vagary of stone tool styles. Phil Geib contends in a few other publications that during the archaic period, the Northern Colorado Plateau tradition was centered on the Colorado, Green, and Lower San Juan River drainages, or approximately what is now Glen Canyon National Recreation Area, and the Southern Colorado Plateau tradition was centered on the Little Colorado River drainage not far from Flagstaff, which makes Bear's Ears the periphery or backwoods of both, where, as in all peripheral settings, attachment to respective cultural heartlands was thin and at least some of the locals commingled to create diverse new variants. I had the pleasure of acting as a crew chief on three of those wilderness volunteers' excursions in the Dark Canyon wilderness, and the most exciting of them was the second year. Irwin had decided to situate base camp near a spring known to be fairly reliable, and we approached it from two angles. He and I, along with the other seasonal archaeologist, hauled all the heavy equipment about halfway along the canyon bottom by ATV until we reached the non-motorized zone, then hauled it the rest of the way on horseback with the help of a couple more Forest Service folks. We would meet everyone else at the appointed rendezvous spot. I rode a horse part of the way, a wily equestrian oaf named Taz, short, I'm fairly certain, for Tasmanian dickhead. Razmataz, as it turned out. Thanks to him, I learned more than I ever thought necessary about trees and the tensile resilience of their lowermost branches relative to the consistent metric of my face. I respect horses, but I stop far short of loving or even liking them overmuch. Taz had a lot to do with this. The volunteers and trip leaders came down via a connecting trail, hauling all their personal goods on their backs, and we met and set up base camp in a spot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.